Yeah, good evening everyone. I hope you had some good food and I hope you won't be too busy digesting your food and hope you can stay awake for a little while. I'm going to talk about my latest side project, which is the Azure Functions Update Twitter bot. Quite a long name, but this is it. I'm now actually at 162 followers since today, so I'm really happy that I'm still increasing my follower count. But what this bot does is it monitors many GitHub repositories, and if one of those repositories has a new release available, and they're all about Azure Functions, then this bot will pick up that release information and post a tweet. And that's basically it. And I had a lot of fun making that over the last couple of weeks. And that's what this talk is about. I'm Mark Dijker. I'm a consultant for Xperit, dealing with only Azure and mostly also the serverless part of Azure. So I'm working with Event Hubs and Cosmos DB and Azure Functions and Stream Analytics. Lots of great possibilities in the Azure platform. This picture I've edited myself as well. I'm also doing lots of graphical stuff. And this is a technique called pixel sorting. So the pixels are sorted by brightness. You can do it in different directions and stuff. So I like to play around with these things. So I'm taking the real old-fashioned waterfall approach for this presentation. So we go from design lines all the way down to production. So let's get started with the idea behind this project. It mostly comes from my own experience quite a while back when the Azure Functions was still in preview. And I was happily coding away my functions in Visual Studio. And a couple of days or a week later, I would continue. And then it would break. It wouldn't work anymore. And it happened quite a lot of times. And of course, partly it was my fault probably because I did something stupid. But very often it was also the case that things got outdated and versions got mismatched between the runtime and some packages and some tooling. And it didn't really result in development experience. Like I said, this was the experience quite a while ago when a lot of things were in preview. This is definitely not the case anymore now. But yeah, it got me thinking from why is it so difficult to keep everything updated, and why am I not aware of all these things? Because the whole Azure Functions ecosystem is quite a big thing. I mean, does anyone can give a number how many packages and runtimes there are at the moment? Just any number?
Seven.
No, up, higher.
Couple of dozen.
Yeah, the close. Yeah, yeah. It's I've counted around 18 now, but there's probably more. You have all kinds of different language workers and language runtimes, Java and Python now, and of course the C sharp and F sharp ones. And there are really a lot of extensions to integrate with all kinds of other parts in Azure. So as a developer, you probably won't work with all of them because then you would touch every extension, every language. For let's say more or less average project with a couple of integrations, you'll probably hit around six or seven of these components. And I believe when you're a developer, you need to be aware of the latest releases and what's going on, what are the pros and cons of the latest versions of all of these things. So it's quite a bit to take into account. So this is my use case for this project. So as a developer, I want to be notified when new releases in order to stay up to date. So quite a simple task, you would say. So this is the functional flow. So whenever a new release is there of something, I want to get a notification, and then I would be happy.
The trigger for the new release, this will happen when someone just adds a new release in GitHub.
I'll get to that more in more detail, need because I will cover all the options now, and I'll explain where I landed on. But I'll get to that part. Yeah, but thanks. Indeed, if there are questions, just throw them at me. So let's talk about the design part. Indeed, we need a source where the information comes from, of course, which versions or releases of packages are there. And there are quite a bit of options. One of my colleagues also made a Twitter bot quite a while ago about AKS versions in Azure. And he used the Azure API to query directly which version of AKS is running in which region. That works fine for that. But I have very little use to directly query Azure, because yeah, of course I can get a runtime version and stuff like that, but yeah, the whole ecosystem is much, much bigger than only what is currently running in Azure. So this wasn't good for me. Well, of course, NuGet also is quite a logical choice because yeah, there are a lot of experience and stuff is in NuGet, but again, a lot of tooling isn't, and especially we have the Java stuff now, and also Python and JavaScript and TypeScript things as well. This is not on NuGet, so that also quickly was not the right choice. So finally, I settled on GitHub because Microsoft is really into open source, and all of the new stuff is mostly now on GitHub. Not everything yet, but Azure Function-wise, is mostly there. And indeed, GitHub also provides a very good API to communicate with. And indeed, I'm using indeed the GitHub releases to check from did they publish a new release in one of their repositories. Not everyone uses the releases functionality in GitHub, so I do monitor some repositories, but they don't. The teams don't actually put release information in there. So then I also can't notify them. So what I'm currently doing now is just go over all of these repositories, and if the teams are not using GitHub releases yet, then I'll just mention it and file an issue on their GitHub repo. Van hey, could you please start using releases so that my Twitter bot can pick up the releases and tweet about it. So, and some people are doing it now. So that GitHub is a good source for it. Of course, I also need to send out notifications. First I thought, okay, should you use maybe email as a notification instead? Because you can also have some nice aggregation, maybe so every week or every month or something to show you which updates are there. I want to keep the barriers low as possible, so I didn't want to have to deal with registration or capturing emails and stuff like that. So I didn't do email. Maybe I'll include it in the future, but I chose for Twitter instead. And Twitter is a platform. A lot of IT people are on it already, and it seemed like a logical fit for this project. I also need to store some things because I need to know which GitHub repositories I need to check. So I have a bit of configuration which I need to capture, and then I also want to capture the releases which I pull from GitHub, because I want to know which information I already have, because I need to compare it then next time I query GitHub. So I don't need a lot of storage, but there are not a lot of requirements. The objects which I store are pretty small. So I briefly compared Cosmos versus table storage, but it was a pretty clear answer. Also cost-wise, table storage is really a good fit because I just have tiny, simple, flat objects, no big documents or whatever, and no difficult stuff to do. So table storage it is. And then finally, I need to have a place for my logic because I need to have this kind of workflow which I need to need to go through. I could have done definitely a large part in logic apps because it had a lot of good integrations, definitely with Twitter as well. But since it's about Azure Functions anyway, I really wanted to have the whole thing in Azure Functions, especially if you combine it with Drupal functions. Are people familiar with Drupal functions here? Okay, some. Yeah, so with Drupal function, you can actually write a workflow in code. So I'll show you some code later on how that looks like. So instead of designing your workflow visually in Logic Apps, you can just write C# code or JavaScript code and define your orchestration and your workflow in your code. So that's what I settled on. So then I thought about, what kind of information do I want to capture, and we'll go through my application. So I defined some domain models. Well, the first one is about the configuration. So which GitHub repositories do I need to query? So there's not a lot of information in there, mainly the name of the owner of the repository and the repository name and a few other bits of data, like timestamps and stuff. Another domain model is the actual release information. I query GitHub with the latest release. That has its own model, but that contains a lot of information which I don't need, so I map it to my own model, which is the repository release. And both of them I put in table storage. Another model I have is called latest releases. because you'll see it in the workflow later on. I query GitHub for the latest release, but then I also query my own releases storage to see which I retrieved earlier. And then I do a comparison of the two. And that comparison is done in a separate object called latest releases. And there's some logic in there, which I'll show later, which determines, hey, is this GitHub release, is it new? And if yes, then I should indeed save it again and I should post it. The final model I have is the actual update message, which is just very simple. It contains a title and a string for the content, which will be sent to Twitter. So this is the whole flow. It's based on a timer. It runs every hour, and the first thing it does is it actually gets the configurations from table storage. So right now there are about 20 or so configurations in there, one record for each repository I want to check. So then I'm going to do two things. For each of the repositories, I'm querying GitHub to get the release information in there. Parallel. And what I'm also doing is I query my own releases table if I have some history information about this repository. I will compare what I have from GitHub and what I have from history, and based on that, yes, what I have now is something new. So if so, then I want to save it. I save it in my release table, and then I'll also post it. So not a very complicated flow, but this can be captured very nicely in Azure Functions, and especially with Jabber functions. Okay, so next up, development of it. Again, I'll use this sheet to zoom in and into all the parts, and then I'll also show you all the code that belongs to it. So Jabber functions, when you start working with it, you have three different function roles you have to work with. The first one is called the orchestration client, or the orchestration starter, and that's a function which kicks off a new instance of your orchestration. So in this case, we have a timer trigger function that starts a new orchestration every hour. So I won't show the code of that, it's really tiny. By the way, I will share the slides with you and also the link to the repos there, so you'll have all the information. Very, very tiny function which triggers every hour, and that kicks off the orchestration. So then another function role, so that's called an orchestration function. And that contains the logic, which actually does all the chaining of the function and makes calls to all these individual functions, because every orange box, except this one, is actually an individual function. And you connect those functions to each other in this orchestration function. The last function role you have in your activity in Jabber functions are called activity functions. And those are the actual individual functions which do the heavy lifting. So the activity functions make the calls to databases, make calls to different APIs and that kind of stuff. You don't do that in your orchestration function. Your orchestration function is purely to do all of the chaining of the functions and do stuff like fan out, fan in. For instance, fan out is what I do here, because here I have 20 different repositories. And then for each of those 20, I want to get some results. So this process is fanning out, because I want to do this 20 times. I'm also going to do this 20 times. But then I'm fanning in again to aggregate all the results and do a comparison. So that's architectural pattern, the fan out, fan in, fits very nicely in Jabber functions. Another benefit of using Jabber functions is that the orchestrations are stateful. So state is actually managed by Jabber functions. The framework uses table storage and uses queues to control the logic flow. And the nice benefit of that is whenever something goes wrong, for instance, whenever GitHub is down for a couple of seconds, you can very easily have the framework retry the calls to that activity. So maybe this activity first fails because there was a problem with GitHub. The framework can then retry this several times. You can configure that, how many times it does that, and how quickly it will do that. So you can really make your whole orchestration then quite resilient by introducing these retry mechanisms. So this is a screenshot from the orchestration function. You can see here that we have it annotated with orchestration trigger, so that's why it's identified as an orchestration function. One of the first things it does is it makes a call to one of the activity functions, the get repository configurations. So it does that with this method, call activity with retry async. Well, it's already quite explicit, so an activity will be called and it will also be retried if it fails. We expect a list of repository configurations back. We provide some retry options, and for this activity we don't provide any input. We just query it with a known partition key. The next thing it will do is when we have configurations, then we will prepare a list. We're going to actually prepare several lists. But this first list is for capturing the tasks, which eventually contain the calls to GitHub. So we first define a new list here. But then we actually fill the list up with the tasks which calls the next activity that's calling GitHub to get the latest releases from. So notice the difference here. Here with this call activity we try async, we wait for it. So we immediately have the result. But here we do, let's say, define the call. But that's a task and we're not awaiting it here. We're just adding it to this list of tasks. And what we do in the end is we do await task when all. So only when the orchestration is here, it will do that fan out and make the calls to all of those 20 tasks, and then wait until they're all finished, and then we have the result from all of the calls going out to GitHub. And this is the remainder of the orchestration function code. So again, once all the calls are made to GitHub and once all of the calls are made to our own releases history, we again iterate over the all the configurations we have, so the 20 repos. Then I make that latest release object, and I put the latest release from GitHub in there, and I put the latest history release in there. And then I've got some methods in there, some properties actually, which contain some logic, which I'll show later on, which determine, okay, is this GitHub release, is it new? And if so, should it be stored? So then I make another call to my save latest release function, which actually saves it to stable storage. And if that save is successful, then I'll do the next part and actually also post it to Twitter. So yeah, as you can see, the code is, I think, quite readable. If you can do just C# programming, you can definitely write your orchestration quite easily. Okay, so now let's zoom in into some of the individual parts. So the first part is actually getting the configuration flow from table storage into my orchestration. So this is a screenshot from what's there in table storage. Who's familiar with table storage? Okay, quite a lot. Okay, that's good. So I'll show you some. I deliberately did this partition key for repositories. I mean, it's all the same, but I do that because I want to get all the repository configurations all in one go. So I just query based on this partition key, and then I get all these records back. I also did this because currently it contains more than just repositories, because currently I can also do updates for blog posts related for Azure Functions, and later on I also want to capture, for instance, NuGet updates and stuff. So I can already accommodate new configurations by having this this partition key. Well, since you know already quite a lot about table storage, but these are the available data types in table storage, should be fine. One of the things I did run into was that certain characters are not allowed in partition or row keys. It didn't run into issues with the actual GitHub implementation part, but I was using for blog posts. I think I was using titles or partial URLs as a row key, and that did have some number signs or question mark, I think, in the in there. So then I got some errors with table storage. So if you're not sure if your partition or row key can contain indeed invalid characters, make sure you do a cleanup of your partition and row keys before you actually try to store it in table storage. So this is the repository configuration model. Nothing really fancy here, except what I just mentioned. I do a kind of sanitization step on the key to make sure there's no invalid characters in there. So this is the actual activity function, which actually puts it into or retrieves it from storage. So there's a table input binding here. So you have a cloud table available, and here I define a query just based on that partition key, which is just a constant, because I know I want to query all my repositories. And then I do a execute query here to get back all the configurations. Okay, the second part is mostly the same, because again, it's about retrieving information from table storage, but this time it's the releases, if they are available. So this is what I captured up to now for release information. So in this case, the partition key is the name of the repository, and that is because when I want to query it, I query it just by repository name. The row key is in this case a combination of the GitHub release ID combined with the tag name. It's actually more complicated than it needs to be. This release ID is already unique. That should have been enough, but I thought differently otherwise when I did this. What I did find out when I was storing this information, that the release name is sometimes just empty, because it's apparently optional. And sometimes it's exactly the same as the tag name. So, and initially my logic, which constructed the Twitter message, did not take it into account. I thought there would always be a release name and stuff like that, but apparently there wasn't. So this is the model for the repository release. Again, nothing really strange here. And this is the activity then to collect the results. Again, we have a table input binding here, and again, a query, same as before, because we just want to get all the results for just one partition. And then actually sort by the created add date, and I just get the latest one. So I do a query everything. So I do want all of the releases, but I just get the most recent one. Okay, then something slightly more interesting. So how do we get the information from GitHub? Well, like I said, GitHub has a very good good API, a very good REST API. So when you run it through Postman, or I do it here through the REST client in VS Code, you can just go to api.github.com and go to a repos and then the owner of the repo, and then the name of the repo, releases/latest, and then you get the latest release back, and it contains really a lot of information, and much more than I need. I didn't want to do it like this. I didn't want to go straight to the HTTP client. I wanted to write as little as code as possible. So I took a dependency on octokit.net, which is really, they provide a lot of good libraries in many languages to query the GitHub API. And they also have a really awesome logo, I think, which is of course very important. But yeah, they really provide very good good information about how to use this, and it's really super simple. I was really pleasantly surprised by that. So this is the activity which deals with retrieving the stuff from GitHub. And the only thing which is not here is that I created a client in here, but I can show that later. But this is the part where you actually use the client, and you can just say client.repository.release and then get latest, and just provide the name of the owner name and then the repository name, and that gets the latest release for you. So it's really super simple. I did find out the hard way, like I mentioned before, some teams are using GitHub, but they're not using releases. And when you do query for a release which is not there, then you get a 404. So that's why finally I do it in a try catch. I catch the not found exception, which I just ignore because I can't do anything about it. I do log it, once I see it, I will file an issue with that repository. Could you please use release information? So, I also found out the hard way that it returns a 404. So good lesson there. So the compare releases one is slightly different because that's not an individual activity function. That's just a class, the latest releases class, which has some logic. And yeah, this is the majority of that logic. So there's this is new and should be stored a property in there. When this object is created, I put the GitHub release in there and the latest release from history in there. And it will just check from am I a null release? I created this type myself. It's a special case type because I don't want to deal with, let's say, raw nulls. I prefer to have this null releases, the special case types. If you can't get anything from GitHub, of course, there's nothing to post. So then indeed it's not new and should not be stored. When the result from history is null, well, then it's probably something new because we have something from GitHub, but not from history. So it's fine. And if I from GitHub and from history, then I compare the release IDs. So initially, the Twitter bot only used this top function, which was fine. I had like 5 or 6 repositories configured from the start, late February, and was working fine. But then I went to add some more repositories to the configuration. So I was adding more and more repositories. Things still was fine. But some repositories had release information which was quite old, like months old. So when I added that to my configuration, this was then true. There was something from GitHub. This was false. So my logic thought, okay, I did find a new release, and I'm going to save it, and I'm going to tweet about it. But it was not really newsworthy. It was a release from months old. So yeah, that was not really a nice way to deal with that. So then I added this function from is new should be posted, which basically does the same thing, but also checks from is this release within a certain time window. And I've just hard coded it to 2 days. So whenever I configure a new release to be monitored, then it's only posted when the release information is within the 2 days. So then saving the releases to storage. It's a very, very, very tiny one. Here I have a table output binding. You can see that I'm using the iasync collector. And just add there. I did run into an issue when I was messing around with the row keys, and things weren't all right there. So I did put in a try catch and returning false if there was some kind of issue there. Because initially I was doing and the save to history, and I was doing the post, let's say, in one step, or at least consecutively. But now I only want to do the post to Twitter when I've actually captured the release to storage. Because, for instance, when I'm not storing something and the next hour the orchestration is triggered again it tries to store it, but it doesn't, but it does post to Twitter. So it can lead to a strange situation when you always are posted to Twitter, but you're never storing the latest release information. And I wanted to prevent that. Okay, final bit, posting of the update. This was a bit more involved than the GitHub one, because in order to really use the Twitter API, you need a developer account, which is not too big of a deal. You just need a regular Twitter account first, and then you can go to this URL, developer.twitter.com. Then you hit this button, apply for developer account, and there you need to supply loads and loads of information, and you need to promise that you won't do anything bad, and you follow all of Twitter's rules and stuff like that. But then you do have a developer account quite quickly. You needed to wait maybe just a couple of hours or so. It wasn't that bad. I thought it was going to be worse. But once you have that, you can do an effort registration in there, and then you get some keys and tokens and stuff that you can use in your application. Again, I was using a C# library to manage the heavy lifting for me, called TweetInvy. I actually didn't knew of this library before up to a couple of months ago. It's working quite well. I need to do very little coding for this. I did notice there hasn't been a lot of maintenance done on this library, so I'm not sure how future-proof this one is. So be careful if you want to use this. The actual code is really almost nothing. Of course, you can see I have my all the keys and secrets currently in my environment variables. But the actual code is just this. So you create a new Twitter credentials with all those keys, and then you do this operation when you actually publish a tweet. So yeah, coding wise, it's very little effort. This part shows how actually going to construct the update message based on a release. It's not really fancy. Again, like I explained before, initially it was just this piece of text constructing the sentence, but then it turned out that the release could be empty and that sometimes the release name is the same as the tag name, which resulted in some strange English sentences. So that's why I put some logic in there to construct a proper sentence in case some things are empty. Okay, final bit going to production. Yeah, like I mentioned, all the source code is in GitHub, which is fine. I like it for all my open source source projects. The whole CI/CD part is in Azure DevOps. So I hacker figured a build pipeline in Azure DevOps which just connects to GitHub. And whenever I merge from my development branch to my master branch, it just triggers this build, and it will publish an artifact, and that artifact will be picked up by the release pipeline, which just has just very straightforward. It stops the Azure Function instance and it updates it, and it starts the instance again. So it was quite trivial to set this up. So whenever I do a merge to master, everything is done automatically. Yeah, so it will be deployed automatically. I think up to now, I maybe have done maybe seven releases or something. And I'm also like dog feeding it now because I've also configured the Twitter bot also in the configuration. So whenever I do an update, the Twitter bot actually sends a tweet about its own update. So this is a snapshot from Application Insights. Taken a couple of days ago. I really liked the Application Insights because it's really, at a glance you see what's going on, especially if you have maybe a bit bigger projects with a bit more integration stuff. But this was already quite insightful because I explicitly set it to, okay, give me an overview of the last 24 hours. And then I saw these 22 instances. I thought, this Twitter bot is triggered every 24 hours, and I've got 22 instances. So that's weird. So I looked up. It was triggered every hour, and it was. So I pulled up log analytics and which request instances, and then it appeared that two instances were used twice for execution. I didn't thought that happened. Could clearly see that there were twice as many requests for two instances compared to the other ones. So that was explained easily, but was interesting. But you see two red lines here, and yeah, red lines are usually you need a danger sign, but both of them are explainable. We already talked about API and some repos don't have releases, but I am actually querying the releases, those generate 404s. So these errors are actually the release not found information stuff. So that's fine. The other one, those are dependency errors. I'm using the Azure Functions and Durable Functions, which relies heavily on table storage interaction. And that uses also some API calls like create table if not exists and those kind of things, and that internally checks if something exists, and if it doesn't exist it will also throw a 404, which is in the durable functions code, which I don't have to deal about. They also just consume the exception, so I don't see any direct exceptions, but they are dependency exceptions which do show up in Application Insights, so I don't have to worry about this. It's also on the radar of the Durable Functions team, and yeah, they will eventually pick that issue up and make sure it doesn't appear anymore as a dependency exception. But yeah, it does raise some questions when you initially see this from what's going on, and everything appears to be fine, but like 50% of the calls goes wrong. What's that?
Who is the Durable Functions team? Is that Microsoft?
Yeah. Oh. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Okay, well. Some very good news. So over the last 2 months, this is are the total costs, 40 cents. Yeah, that's pretty nice. I mean, yeah, admittedly, it's a very low volume thing. I mean, it's only, it's triggered every hour. Then it does about 60 to 70 function executions. It's really low volume, but still, it's impressive. I couldn't have done this with an app service or something like that. This amount of money, and also when you look at how the pricing is built up, yeah, it's mostly you pay for the storage, which actually is mostly then also durable functions. So yeah, it's something to keep in mind of. But yeah, I was pleasantly surprised to see this. I had a budget alert set for €5 a month, so 40 cents per 2 months. So yeah, I'm not even hitting my budget alert. So that's nice. But yeah, the whole thing about the session is not really about the Twitter bot, but it's more like what you can achieve in just actually a couple of days. Because yeah, I've been working on the Twitter bot for really quite some evenings in a week now. I went to production after just 5 evenings of work. So this is my initial commit, 1st of February, and then later that month, the 27th, it went to production. It started tweeting. So it's only 7 commits, but just 5 evenings of work. And yeah, I was really pleasantly surprised that with that little effort, you can already achieve something. So that's really my take-home message of this session. If you really need to use the right components, and not only the right Azure services, but also existing packages which are out there, yeah, you can achieve really quite a lot in not too much of time. Again, if you want to be notified of Azure Function stuff, follow the bot. And yeah, I will extend also its functionality you need pretty soon with more stuff. And yeah, if you want to see the code, or if you want to create your own Twitter bot, fork it. It's really quite configurable because most of it is in table storage anyway. So it's really really flexible. And yeah, if you want to know more, talk about serverless or anything, feel free to contact me. Thank you. Any questions now, or we can do it later? No, it's actually at least 18 repositories I'm checking. Yeah, exactly. I've got to need a list here of the old repositories I'm checking, and they're all from Azure, all from Microsoft. Yeah, okay. There's one because I'm dog feeding my own Twitter bot, but yeah, it's mostly Azure now. Yeah. And indeed, I don't think these are all of them, so more will be added soon. Yeah. Okay. Anyone else? Okay.
Okay. Why did you do the GitHub releases? Because I could also imagine that you would use the NuGet repository, because I guess that is more accurate than, potentially more accurate than the GitHub releases, right?
Well, yeah, the downside is a lot of things is indeed in NuGet, but it's only .NET focused. And there's also a lot of tooling involved, the Azure Functions core tools and a lot of runtimes and workers not related to .NET at all, and those are not on NuGet. So I am planning to extend the functionality to also monitor that, but as an initial thing, I wanted to target a broad spectrum as possible first.
Yeah.
Ah, okay, to make it more generic, you mean. Okay, interesting one. Okay, yeah. Okay, I'll give it a thought. Yeah. Okay. Cool.
Okay, thank you, Mark.
Cool, thanks.